many of the ones Ed has invested in, particularly Funding Circle. I'll just quickly remind everyone who's on our panel, even though they need a little introduction. Of course, first of all, we have Sean Park, who's founder and chairman of Anthemus, an investment firm, and founding investor in companies including... Betfair, Markets and Zoopla. It's got Eileen Burbage, who's a founding partner of Passion Capital, of course an investor in science, also a government advisor on FinTech. And finally, last but not least, Ed Ray, co-founder of Betfair, Dora, also a pretty big investor in FinTech, including Funding Circle, as I mentioned. Now, Sean, just to start off with, you had a fascinating presentation where you covered a lot of ground. I noticed you didn't mention the B word in any of that Brexit, and I won't spend too long talking about that, but you know, this is unavoidable in terms of the impacts on FinTech, isn't it? Or am I wrong, it's not going to have a big impact on what British FinTech firms, do you think?
So, I'm probably the wrong person to ask because, as our esteemed Prime Minister said, I'm a citizen of nowhere. Canadian, I was educated in the US, I lived in France, in the UK, and now I'm in Switzerland. And really, without any irony or any view, the way that we look at the world is not through a nation-state lens. Even though we acknowledge that, especially in financial services, because the regulation is important, but maybe just to put a bow around that, I wonder how relevant, either way, good or bad, Brexit will be, because as long as we have nation states, and even in the context of the EU, there are national regulators that have remained very important. And I think, again, to my point on regulation of startups, I think it's probably an opportunity either way for startups. If you're running a giant bank or insurance company that's built all this infrastructure to deal with regulation as it is, it's more disruptive.
I know your thoughts as both a government advisor and investor in FinTech businesses. Are you worried?
So I'm not worried, especially when you remind me I'm supposed to be talking on behalf of the government. But I'm not actually going to answer with that point of view. For personally, and I guess taking all of the differences into account, I do think Brexit is obviously a big distraction for the UK tech sector, whether it was FinTech or otherwise. I do believe that actually the biggest risk, so I think there are sort of tactical concerns like past warning, like financial services and regulation, as Sean was mentioning, I think the biggest risk is talent. So if you've got, the bigger banks leaving or sort of saying that they're going to set up the next 5,000-person office in Frankfurt instead of London, that's 5,000 talented individuals that we would like to hire and bring into the FinTech ecosystem and the startups that won't be here in London locally. Of course, we need to continue to attract that talent. So I actually think that's the most material impact for us.
Absolutely. I was talking to a founder earlier who was saying that he would drop off to a few international staff, and he was saying that, pre-Brexit would be by your hand on type territory, and now there's a lot of people having second thoughts. Ed, is that something that your portfolio companies work in this area?
First of all, I must say, I love the way that Sean said, I'm not a citizen of anywhere, and he goes to Mark, Prime Minister. I think it's a complete red herring.
Right.
If we step in 20 years' time, we'll look back. It will be seen as a small dislocation. We're all trying to create completely change the way the industry moves, and this is a small, single year dislocation. It will have some impact. Bear in mind that a lot of the businesses that are regulated here are regulated on national regulation and don't already passport anyway. For them, massive opportunity, right? Because big banks suddenly have passporting. They don't have it. So there's as much an opportunity as there is a threat. And I think we just have to sort of, it's something that is there. Small companies generally, all the ones I'm involved in, are just taking it in their stride. And what irritates me is that we spend not that this is your first question, but we spend a huge amount of time talking about it. And it's something that I think in 2 years' time, we'll go, why do you spend so long talking about it?
Well, I think we're very much. Okay, right. There's just one final question on this Brexit thing. We hear a lot of talk about it, because London is, rightly sort of presented as a leader, then we hear, and I think genuinely, talk of Germany
finding, to what extent do you think they represent a serious threat to the London city and fintech? It's like Harrison Billy.
I mean, I think some people might choose to go, but I don't think it's a serious threat. I kind of agree with Ed that the most resilient, obviously, the best companies, the nation companies, are going to get on with it. I sort of said before that I think in the United States suffers from this as well. If in Germany you had Frankfurt and Berlin, those two ecosystems, where Frankfurt is the center of the financial sector and services for Germany, and Berlin is where the heart of innovation is present, you have those in the same metropolitan area, it might be a bit of a risk. Or similarly, if you have the United States or New York and Silicon Valley are so far apart. Since that doesn't exist anywhere else in Europe, I think London is pretty safe in terms of leading the field.
Yeah, unless Berlin gets an airport and flights get a little bit more. Just to pick up on that point, we don't look at things through a lens of relationship state, but I think when you're building businesses, it's actually an urban area. So I think you have to separate London and the UK. There might be London, Paris, Berlin, New York, Boston, the Bay Area, Los Angeles. It's not the United States or the UK, it's these centers, because it's talent. It's about attracting that talent. I think that's the biggest risk. If I worry about anything, and this is actually true in activists too, I don't know if we have 18 nationalities out of our 50 odd people. If there were to be a hard Brexit and all of the non-UK citizens had to leave, that would impact us, and I think a lot of people would.
I don't want to get into the politics of Brexit, because I'll put you down. I think we're all jumping to really extreme examples. Brexit is not about that. And I'm absolutely confident that access to talent is really, really key. Let's not make any blame about that. Politicians know that. I'm absolutely convinced that post whatever deal we get in Brexit, we will still have access to the right talent. And I think that's really
important. So moving on from Brexit, in terms of the leading fintech companies at the moment, so the ones that have raised the most capital probably springs to mind, TransferWise, Google, companies that you've invested in. What if anything is stopping them becoming an absolute global giant that is based in the UK, not one that is acquired from overseas? Is anything stopping them, Eileen?
I don't think anything's stopping them. I think I would be better positioned, especially with respect to my circle, but in terms of my point, nothing's stopping them. And I think they are global successes now. They are leaders in their categories, and so they're demonstrating that you can do that here in the UK, and there's nothing standing in the way.
Yeah, I mean, look, Funding Circle is already the single largest SME lender in the world. So your argument about
it's a net lender,
it's a bigger lender to SMEs.
RBS is a bigger lender too.
Definition of SMEs is so I don't think there's anything stopping.
Right.
And I think we spend a lot of time in particularly in this part of the world, sort of focusing on why we haven't achieved XYZ. In fact, rather than what we have achieved. And, if you take an arm, and why did they sell out to SoftBank? It's very top of the right hand, because everyone doesn't expect that, whether they should or shouldn't have done it. It's still a great business, it was founded here, and most of it is still here. Who the shareholders are actually doesn't really change what the fundamental DNA of that business is. We need to get away from this who owns it now. So, I don't think there's anything something. I have to say, from a fintech point of view, there is no city in the world I would rather be based in. Regulation in terms of time zone, in terms of language, in terms of rule of law, all of those kind of things. Yes, we've got some headwinds coming, but I'd still rather be here than anywhere else. I think that's a key thrust of the world.
Yeah, and that's why London has been for 200, 300 years, maybe longer, a financial center. The time zone is a big deal. One of the things I love about investing in financial services companies is it's not a winner-take-all market. Even if you put aside startups, if you look at incumbents, even in concentrated markets like the UK and banking of France, people have market shares, like giant market shares of 10, 15, 20%. And these are very, very big businesses. So it's unlike, let's say, a Google or a Facebook, where it is a winner-take-all, and you have to, it's like one person takes everything, and there's nothing for the rest of them. And ironically, coming back to my sort of the greenfield opportunity for startups like Funding Circle and others, is they're in a much, much better position because of their fundamental business models to port this business model into new markets. And we're starting to see that with some of them. It's still early days. So there's, I think there's a bigger chance, this might, I don't know, get me into hot water, but there's a much higher chance of a funding circle or their ilk becoming a global brand and having global success than an RBS or a Chase or a Citibank or even a Bank of China or ICBC.
So I think one of the things when you look at business like this is to do the sort of what I call the blank piece of paper test. So try and forget everything you know about the industry as it is today and go, right, if I'm designing from scratch with no knowledge at all, how would I design this business? And if you would design it a different way to the way it is today, then absolutely that industry is ripe for disruption. And if you look at all of these new tech businesses, you're sort of thinking, well, actually, they're designed the way they should be designed. And the fact that we're talking about RBS is because we're sort of trying, we've got an eye on the past rather than on the eye on how it should be. And the successful businesses are the ones that are sort of saying, right, I'm forgetting everything I know, and I'm starting from scratch, and I'm building it the way it should be built today.
These are still extremely large organizations, right? So how are they going to react? Are they going to try and acquire the likes of Tide? Tide becomes a business. Are they going to try and buy Tide? Are they going to try and buy a funding circle transfer? Why do they try and do it from within their own organization, which there'd be various problems with? Or do they just die eventually over the next 30 years? I think you used this phrase, Sean, didn't you, in a video you made back in 2005, where you said something like that. Your prediction was they'd become sort of just unregulated pools of capital and little else. Well, what happens now?
I think it's all of the above. I think many will rust away. So I don't think it'll be very spectacular. There's always the possibility of exogenous market events like in 2008 taking out a Lehman or a Merrill Lynch. But I think the main failure mode for the ones that fail will be slow decline, rusting away. There will be ones that manage to transition both, I think more through M&A, and I'd say of the big sort of global Western banks, BBVA is probably the vanguard of this. I think the jury's still out. They have a very aggressive and smart management team, but we'll see if they're successful, but they're certainly putting a bet on that. They're building stuff internally and buying companies. And then there's others that will try to reinvent themselves from within. And on paper, I don't think that's impossible. Indeed, at Anthem, as part of our business, is helping some of those institutions do that. But it's enormously challenging. And I have enormous empathy for the leadership teams of these businesses because it's not like it was 10 years ago where the dinosaurs, they don't get it. There's always a few Forrest Gumps in the boardroom. But most of the people leading these large financial institutions, they get it. But it's like turning, a super tanker. And whether or not they can succeed, I think the jury is out.
I mean, if we were to ask you where you thought the next innovation is going to come from in fintechs, we've seen, we've spoken about peer-to-peer lending, innovation there. Obviously, we've seen a lot of innovation around things like currency transfer. Where's the next wave going to come from? Is it insurance? Is it blockchain? Is it cybersecurity, as Sean mentioned in his presentation?
I think it's definitely in those areas that you just mentioned, cybersecurity, insurance, and blockchain. But I think, investors like Ed and Sean, they will have been investing across the board for years and years and years. But I think it's true that the hype or a lot of the attention so far has been on services. So I would call this consumer services, even if they're to SMEs as their consumer and their customer. So they're lending their products that are being offered to a customer that could be a business or an individual. And I think what we're going to start seeing now is a lot more attention in addition to sage investors like Sean and Ed going into enterprise type financial services. So companies that are offering services to FS providers. So back of the plumbing, whether it's compliance, it's regulatory management, it's KYC, it's AML, it's actually down into the plumbing behind, sort of underneath the surface of the water, and not actually trying to do customer acquisition, whether that's consumer or businesses. I think that's what's going to start getting a lot more.
Ed, what are the kind of interesting decks that are crossing your desk at the moment getting you excited?
Well, I agree with what Ryan said. I mean, to me, for example, Bitcoin is not blockchain. I mean, blockchain is way more than that at the moment. Everyone's, I don't have a view on Bitcoin, so I'm not smart enough to have a view on this one. But I think blockchain actually has applications way more than that. So, for example, the friction of just financial services as a whole is huge. Actually, blockchain could be fantastically know insurance eggs are eggs. If I was thinking about insurance now, I would not design it the way it is today, which means by my little model, it has to be disruptive. And there are some very, very smart things happening in insurance now. And to me, that's the next big, yeah. The next big thing.
Now you mentioned Bitcoin, and as you said, Sean, you know, this is something we could have a whole other session on. I just want to, I felt like I couldn't avoid it, given I think we sort of got above $11,000 at one point today. How sort of worried do you think the fintech industry should be about the prospects of a crash, if indeed that's likely?
Yeah, I don't, right now today, I don't think it's very worrying, because the wealth, whether it's real or paper, or disappears or remains, is very, very concentrated. I think if this continues to go on, and you know, the dentist in Belgium or the doctor in Alabama starts losing their life savings, if there is a correction, that could be more problematic. But there's probably in the short term a benefit, and there's a lot of you know, potentially wealthy people. It got manifested in the ICO craze in the last year, but there could be more financing. Again, coming back to my sort of creative disruption, that at a societal level, this is a good thing. At an individual level, it's really hard to tell right now. It is a mania, there is a bubble, but I don't say that. I don't think that's a bad thing. This is how creative disruption has happened in economies, at least since the dawn of the industrial era. So I wouldn't be particularly worried about it. In a strange way, if it sort of continues in a slow climb and starts to infect the financial system, even though the paper market cap of the blockchain world, it's essentially Bitcoin and Ethereum, or sort of 80% of it is $300 billion. I don't think there's a lot of leverage there, and as I said, I think it's, you know, our views is very concentrated in terms of wealth. So there's no systemic risk like we saw with, you know, mortgages and ABS and the trigger of the financial crisis. Leverage is what kills you.
Yeah.
So one to watch is the CME future contract. So and we've seen a couple pitch decks come across, and I'm sure there's more. You know, where people are doing leverage lending against, and being an old derivatives guy and a banking guy, it's like, how do you write a haircutting model for, you know, doing leverage on crypto coins that are moving like 20% a day? But for now, I think it's I think it's actually a good thing in terms of that creative disruption.
I mean, what are your thoughts? Already saying that.